Maximum Life is our way of taking all of the sermons that we deliver at First Baptist Fernandina Beach and distributing them all over the world. The Maximum Life podcast has been heard by literally tens of thousands of people worldwide. The Maximum Life radio show can be heard from South Georgia all the way down to Central Florida on the Salem Network affiliate. You can think of Maximum Life as an amplifier of the message. I often say we cannot make the gospel any better, but we can certainly make it louder. There are three ways that you can help us turn up the volume on the message of God's Word. Number one, follow us on social media. Be sure to like and share the various posts as they speak to your heart. Secondly, pray for us on a regular basis. All that we do is in vain unless God adds His hand of blessing to our ministry. And third, financially partner with us in amplifying the message of Jesus Christ. As a 501c3 tax-exempt organization, 100% of your donation of any amount is tax-deductible to Maximum Life. To give, visit us online at zachterry.com and click the Donate Now tab in the upper right hand of your screen. Thank you in advance for your partnership in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 20, if you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. Revelation, the 20th chapter, as we continue our study through this last of the New Testament books. We're getting to the good part. It's all good, but this is really good. This is the time when Jesus is ruling and reigning. That prayer that He gave us as an example to pray, "Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," is being literally answered in Revelation chapter 20. We're looking today at the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. The word millennial, it means 1,000 years, and it's used 6 times here in chapter 20 of Revelation. Imagine for a moment what it would be like to see the Lord Jesus Christ descending from heaven with thousands upon thousands of His holy ones. His feet touched down on the Mount of Olives, and it split in two, north to south. And He makes His way up to the Temple Mount, and He takes His seat upon a throne there in Jerusalem. Now, this is not new heavens and new earth. We're going to look at it in the coming weeks, but this is the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ. The sin curse is still upon the planet. People still die. And you see this administration of Jesus, the setup, ruling and reigning, where, as the Old Testament predicted, the government shall be upon His shoulder. Now, I want you to imagine what it will be like. No more communist, socialist, no more Democrat or Republican. This is a theocracy, a planet ruled and reigned by the risen Son of God. The Bible, in one sense, can be described as a book about a king and his kingdom. Think of it, there in the beginning, the book of Genesis, He created Adam of the dust of the ground. He breathed into him the breath of life. And then He gave him dominion. That word means rule and authority over the entire planet. He's given dominion. He was King Adam in one very real sense. And His capital city, the city of Eden, the Garden City of Eden. He is to take that city along with His bride, Eve, and they are to fill the earth and subdue it. They are to take what is there in Eden, and they are to multiply, and they are to take Eden and expand its territory all over this uninhabited planet. And that was the great commission for Adam, was to fill the earth and subdue it. But rather than obey his Creator and trust his Creator, he went into league with the evil one, with Satan himself. He believed a lie. He thought the worst about God and His intentions. And so, God cursed mankind. The curse fell upon man, it fell upon woman, it fell upon the earth, it fell upon the serpent, Satan himself. But even in the midst of the curse, we have what is called the proto-evangelion, the proto-gospel. God himself preaching the gospel for the first time. And he says that the day is coming when the woman will give birth to a male child. And that young man will grow up to put right everything that went wrong in Eden. He will crush the head of the serpent. And in the process, he himself, his heel, will be bruised. Now, that was the first utterance of the gospel from the lips of God. And then you have to imagine, you know, they gave birth to Cain and Abel. And you have a male child, and you have to wonder, could this be the one? Could this be the one that God had promised that'll make right what has gone so very wrong? And then Cain raises up, and he kills his brother Abel. Then child after child. You see the birth of Noah. Noah looked like such a good candidate. Maybe he's the one, the righteous among the wicked of the earth. He's the one that heard the command of God to build this great ark and to save his family. It looked like he could be the one, perhaps, until that ark came to rest on the mount. He got off the ark, and what he did after that, they don't tell you about in Vacation Bible School. It was not a pretty sight. Then came Moses. It looked like, surely this is the Lord's anointed king. But he murders a man, and he sins in such a way that he cannot enter into the promised land. Then came David, a man after God's own heart, the giant killer. We sang about him this morning. But then he himself was slain by his own lust. The Old Testament, anticipating the coming of a king, from every act of the priest to every word of the prophet, they're looking for who will be the one God has promised. This seed of the woman, using the masculine, he will crush the head of the serpent. Well, who is he? Where is he going to be? And we get some shadows and types and some promises in the Old Testament. And then we begin the New Testament dispensation. The first thing that happened chronologically, not necessarily in word order, but chronologically, the first event of the New Testament is the appearance of Gabriel to Mary. In Luke 1, verse 30, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive, and in your womb you will bear a son." So here's the woman with the male child. "And you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." So God, lest we mistake it, he comes down. Heaven is sent, the emissary of Gabriel. And Gabriel says, "This is the one that God promised back in Eden. This is the one that will set right everything that has gone wrong. This is the seed of the woman. It's the one who will be called Jesus. And Jesus will be born of the Virgin Mary, and he will become a king, and of his kingdom there will be no end." The first message of the New Testament is the king is coming, and he will have an eternal kingdom. And then that picture fades to black, and it comes into focus on the preaching of one in the wilderness. His name we know as John the Baptist, John the Baptizer. Someone asked me one time, "Pastor, do you really believe that John was a Baptist?" I said, "Well, I've never heard him called John the Episcopalian." You know what I'm saying? So he was the baptizer. So he comes preaching. Well, what do you wonder? What John is preaching? He says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The kingdom, you can reach out and touch it. The kingdom that we've been anticipating since Eden, the kingdom is here. A new king, one like Adam, is coming, a second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ. Then Jesus comes. Matthew 4, verse 17, Matthew summarizes his teaching and says, "From that time forward, Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" It's here. The kingdom is among us. If you take all of the teaching of Jesus, it could be summarized as kingdom and kingdom ethics. Everything that he taught was ultimately about the kingdom of God. after his resurrection. He goes to the cross, he pays for your sin, and he dies upon the cross, he's buried, he overcomes death, hell, and the grave. And then he appears to his faithful. And what do you think he might be speaking about? It says in Acts 1 verse 3, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them 40 days, and speaking of the kingdom of God. His apostles sent into all the world. In Acts 8, 12, Philip, as he preached the good news about the kingdom of God. Acts 19, verse 6, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they were speaking in other tongues and prophesying. There were about 12 men in all, and he entered the synagogue. And for 3 months, he's in a three-month series of sermons. And what's he talking about for 3 months? He's reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. The Bible is about a king and it's his kingdom. Now we come to the book of Revelation, the eschaton, the climax of world history. We've already read in Revelation 11, verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices from heaven. Well, what are these angels shouting from heaven? The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and forever. Well, in the text today, we see how that kingdom is established, how it is literally set up. Now, remember, this comes at the end of a period of time we've described as the Great Tribulation, as a seven-year period of time where, like labor pangs, the wave after wave of just trial and struggle. Have you followed the news this week? Man, we didn't get together on this stuff. When we started this series, I had no idea the type of things that would happen just in a seven-day period of time. But, you know, you just get through COVID, and then they've come up with two or three new ones that they found. What is the new one? Monkey flu or monkey pox or something? If you have that one, stay away from me, please. And we laugh, but man, it is, it's crazy. The school shooting in Texas, the insanity, the chaos of the moment. And in the midst of that chaos, you know, it was so great on Memorial Day to have heroes like the Border Patrol agent who would storm into that room and put a stop to that foolishness. But our hearts are broken today, and even in our own camp among the Southern Baptists, just so much foolishness that's taken place. And so we look around the world, whether it's political or whether it's religious, it seems everywhere you turn, things seem to be falling apart. And we yearn for that day when the Lord will come, just as every generation before us has yearned for him to come and set right what has gone so wrong. Well, the tribulation is completed. The war of Armageddon is over. All of these skirmishes and battles have taken place. The next thing we see in Revelation 20, verse 1, is Satan is restrained. Look at verse 1. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, that ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. So he's got a key and he's got a chain. We're told that the key is to the bottomless pit, the abyss, the spiritual prison. In chapter 9, verse 1, that's the same pit that is opened from which millions of scorpion came and afflicted the wicked for a period of time. This same pit is the one into which Satan is thrown. I don't believe he's thrown there alone. He's thrown there with all of his demonic warriors as well. We see in verse 3, he is thrown into the pit, and it is shut, and it is sealed over him. So he does not go willingly. He does not march into the pit. He is thrown. No one goes into punishment willingly. He's thrown into the pit. No doubt there's a battle that takes place here, as the many we've seen already. So that he may not deceive the nations any longer until the 1,000 years were ended. And after that, he must be released for a little while. We're going to read about that in the coming weeks. But he is thrown into this pit. The demons are thrown into this pit. And for 1,000 years, we're going to see what this planet would be like if he weren't around and if Jesus were ruling and reigning. Somebody says, Pastor, pray for me. The devil's after me. Well, listen to me. A devil may be after you, but it's highly unlikely that the devil is after you. Satan himself probably has bigger fish to fry than any of us in here today. He typically goes after world leaders. He typically goes after the heads of state. You see, up until this point, he's deceiving the nations. How does he deceive the nations? Well, water runs downhill. You capture the mountaintop and the valley will take care of itself. So he goes to the capital, he goes to the head of state. That's why we pray for those in authority over us. No matter who you vote for or who you would have voted for or wish you could vote for, whoever is in elected office, they need your prayers. You should pray for the heads of state of our nation specifically, but of all of the kings of the earth and the presidents and prime ministers. Pray for them. Why? Because they're facing things that you know not of. They're facing things that we cannot comprehend. And they are in a spiritual battle day in and day out. Pray for them that you may live at peace and that your children may live at peace. Now, as soon as he's released from the 1,000 years imprisonment, where does he go immediately? He goes to the heads of state. He goes to those kings and he begins to rustle their feathers and to lead them against the Lord Jesus Christ once again. And so today, that's probably where he is. He's probably in D.C. or London or Beijing or one of these great cities of our planet doing his work. And you're dealing with his subordinates. You're dealing with his demons. We see it all throughout the scriptures. We see him with Pharaoh in Egypt. We see him in Babylon and Persia and Assyria. And so he's working among the world leaders of our day, but not in that day. In that day, we're going to have a period to where you're not going to have to worry about what he's up to. You're not going to have to worry about his schemes and his traps. You do understand we're not ignorant of his deception and his schemes. He has a singular idea for your family. He came not but to steal, kill, and destroy. He hates you with a passion. He hates anything that loves Jesus. And he has his schemes. And he's either winning or he's losing. And many times it depends on what you do with the Word of God that determines whether he's going to win or lose. And so, but for that time, there's no traps. It is sort of a blank field. We have the Lord Jesus Christ ruling and Satan bound. And that brings us to point two. Jesus is reigning. He begins his reign by restoring authority upon the planet. Look at verse 4. Then I saw thrones, and seated on them were those to whom authority to judge was committed. The judges of that day will be more like the judges of the Old Testament than judicial judges of our nation in our day. These are people who have authority to rule. We see at least four groups ruling and reigning with Jesus. We see the Old Testament saints. So there you'll see Abraham, Moses, David. Many believe that David will rule with him, literally in Jerusalem. Imagine what that would be like. We see the apostles in Matthew 19:27. They're given the authority to rule over the 12 tribes of Israel. We see the tribulation martyrs in our own text in verse 4b. It says, also I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God, and those who had not worshiped the beast or its image and had not received the mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and they reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. And then we're told in 2 Timothy 2:12 that we will reign with him. It says, if we endure, Paul writes, we will also reign with him. So imagine that day. Use your sanctified imagination for a minute. Again, the sin curse is not completely lifted. People still live. They get married. They have children. They die. They bury their dead. So you have people upon the earth, not universally all Christian necessarily. But you have people upon the earth living and enduring. You have also this human race of glorified individuals. You see the Old Testament saints, the martyr tribulation saints, you see the apostles, and you see the church ruling and reigning with Jesus. And there are stations of leadership. There will be kings upon the earth in that day. Perhaps some of you, perhaps we have someone in our room today who will one day be a king over a great people. In that day, You say, well, what determines who gets to rule? And what determines who gets the various stations of leadership? Very simply, it's your faithfulness. He who is faithful over the little will be made ruler over the much. And so there's a really interesting way that the Lord does it. He says very often, the last shall be first, and the first will be last. That down here, sometimes those who are in the spotlight may not be in the spotlight in that day. It's all determined by your faithfulness to the Lord and to His Word, and to leverage your life to further His administration here and now. That's why everything you do is important, and it's sanctified, and it has meaning. Because it will be used to determine. Some of you, perhaps we've got somebody in here who's has very little to offer the Lord, but what he does have, he uses it faithfully to the Lord. And he uses his time well for the glory of God. He volunteers to further the kingdom. He takes into account every conversation he has, and he weaves into it the Word of God to further the administration of Christ. He raises his children and influences his grandchildren in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. And maybe in the earth's view, he may not seem like one of the great ones. But it may be that on that day he bows before the Lord and receives a crown and is given authority. Why? He was faithful over little, and he's made ruler over much. And perhaps there are those among us today that by the world's view, it looks like we have it all. We have the education. We have the advancement. We have all of these things. But perhaps we've used it to further our own glory and not use it to further His glory. And on that day, you walk into the kingdom and you expect, oh, now I'm really going to get to rule and show everybody what I can do. And they say to you, well, servant, you didn't do so well. You will be a dog catcher in Nassau County. I'm just using my imagination, but that's kind of how Jesus says it will be. It will be that to those who are faithful here, they will be made rulers there. And those who are not faithful here, not much will be given to them there. Now, we're still not talking about heaven. We're not talking about new heavens and new earth. That's still to come. But this is 1,000 years upon the planet where you will have a station, you will have authority, you will have rule. Jesus, what we saw in his earthly ministry in 3.5 years will be magnified for 1,000. Imagine that. We sat down yesterday, my wife and my daughter, two of our kids are off in school. They're coming home this evening. But I got caught up and I was ahead on things. I had the yard mowed. I had the sermon completed. And I looked at them. I said, what do you guys want to do? And somebody said, well, why don't we go watch that new Top Gun movie? Has anybody seen Top Gun yet? Okay, don't tell me how it ends, okay? But I've heard it's good. I've heard it's really, really good. So I said, let's go watch the new Top Gun movie. And so we delegated to our daughter to find the tickets, the time, and when we need to go. Well, she fouled up, and she thought we meant Doctor Strange. And she should have known better than that. I wasn't about to go watch Doctor Strange, but she wanted to watch Doctor Strange. So we got there, and then we saw that everything was mistaken. But so I'm going to go watch it sometime this weekend. But nevertheless, why did I want to watch that? Because every review of it I've seen has been really good, and the trailers look pretty amazing. Now, the trailers are just a preview of what you get if you buy the ticket and sit down and watch the movie. So what I see, when I'm bringing up my little app on my phone and I see the trailer, imagine that magnified in IMAX. I mean, all of its glory, the best sound, the best video, and you're just sitting there. It's just you and the Lord with popcorn watching the ships and the planes. And man, this is just a little taste, a preview of coming attractions. Well, in a very real sense, the earthly ministry of Jesus was just that. As awesome as it was, one who could walk the earth and speak to storms and they obey him like a obedient child. One who could cast out the demons. One who could cause blind eyes to see with 20/20 vision. One who could speak to the dead and the dead come back to life. Oh, the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. But in a very real sense, as awesome and as magnificent as it was simply a preview of the coming attraction. It was just a little bitty iPhone version of what you're going to get for 1,000 years. Poverty eradicated because we've got one who can multiply the food. Imagine the sicknesses, the disease that have ravaged the planet, and even in this day during the tribulation, all of that gone. We're told that a river will flow out of Jerusalem to the four corners of the earth, and all of this sickness that's in the oceans of the earth will be healed because the Lord Jesus Christ has the power to heal those things. Oh, we marvel at the Lord, that somebody could just touch the hem of His garment and you could see a healing that no doctor could bring about. But in that day, He will rule over the whole planet. Won't that be a wonderful day? Won't it be a wonderful day when for 1,000 years, without Satan's distraction, without the temptations, without him turning father against son and mother against daughter and husband against wife, for 1,000 years, the unbridled rule of our Lord rules and reigns. We read in Isaiah 11, verse 3, "But his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth." So the justice system is no longer fouled up by man's influence. It's perfected under Christ's rule. There's no more of a person getting away with abuse. There's no more cover-ups. There's no more bullying. There's no more high-dollar attorneys able to get the guilty off. There's no more school shootings. All of those things come to a radical end under the administration of the Lord. And it says, "He shall strike the earth with a rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked." So there will be capital punishment, but it will not be drug out for year after year after year. It will happen swiftly under his administration. "Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. And the wolf shall dwell with the lamb." If the wolf and the lamb dwell together, one of them's not going to wake up the next morning. "The leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion, and the fattened calf together. And a little child shall lead them." Do you like pets? Do you have pets at your house? We've got a big, like 70-pound Labrador retriever. We've got a little fluffy cat, and I've got a Quaker parrot. And those we have to administer very carefully because, see, they want to eat one another. The dog wants to eat the cat, and the cat wants to eat the bird. The bird don't know what he wants to eat, but you have to keep them kind of in their own quarters here and now. But in that day, did you know you could take a person, a diver? I've seen it done. And you can, if you have a tank filled with sharks, and those sharks are well fed, you could drop a child in the midst of those sharks, and those sharks will not touch that child. Why? Because they have no need to. They're well fed. They're not hungry. It's their hunger that motivates them to attack. And so in this day, if you go out here to the Atlantic, you don't jump in there with sharks swarming around. You do so at your own peril. But in that day, there's such plentiful food upon this planet, and everybody is so taken care of that former enemies can lie down together and have no fear. And they can be led by a child. What a day that will be. "He will judge between the nations," Isaiah 2, verse 4. "He shall decide disputes for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. And nation shall not lift up its sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." I was in an extended, friendly debate this week over gun control, and it always happens after something, a tragedy like in Texas. There's always the conversation about gun control. And so I was in a conversation with somebody of a different persuasion than I was. And I held my ground, and she held her ground, and we were just in a friendly way, in an intelligent way, going back and forth. And eventually I said, "You know what? I said, we have a disagreement on the meaning and the implications of the Second Amendment. However, let me say that even though I do believe that we have the right to keep and to bear arms, I believe there's going to come a day when those arms will be absolutely unnecessary. And all of our best weapons Imagine the day when they'll say, what are we going to do with these tanks? Well, maybe we can put a plow on the back of them. And maybe we can use them to plow the ground because we have all of these people and we need to feed them, and maybe we can use them as tractors. What are we going to do? Mayport Naval Station. What do you do with a submarine when Jesus is in control? Hey, I know. Let's turn them into cruise ships. And you'll go over to Mayport and take your family on an undersea cruise. Imagine what a day that will be. All of the different minds that we have today that are some of our best minds. If we notice in high school or college that somebody has peculiar potential when it comes to their IQ and their ability to solve problems, what do? We try to influence them and move them in a certain direction, and many times, whether knowingly or unknowingly, they end up working in some way in the manufacturing of weapons. For 9 years of my life, I pastored in North Alabama, which was adjacent to Redstone Arsenal, a big weapons development facility, and NASA. Some of the sharpest minds on the planet were right there in that area. And I just thought, what if these guys that I thank God for, I thank God that they are providing for the defense of our nation. I promise you, we would not be enjoying the good old U.S. of A. if it weren't for men and women like that standing watch as centuries over our borders and over our nation. So I'm thankful for them. But imagine if we had no need of a national defense. Imagine if we could take our greatest minds and imagine if they could create transportation, solve transportation problems. What is it they're looking for right now? Baby food formula. What if instead of creating the next atomic bomb, what if those people were saying, let us solve this shortage of formula problem that we're dealing with? What if they could be used in medical devices? Well, in that day, that's what you're going to see. Somebody said, well, Pastor, won't it just be like we're all Amish? We go back to the garden and you get rid of the iPhones and get rid of the iPads and no more technology. We're just farming all the time. No, see, if you drove here in a car, if you rode here on a bicycle, it's because somebody subdued metal and they leveraged it. They took dominion over it and they formed a vehicle out of it. So our command to subdue the earth and take dominion over the earth, it didn't mean that we're just supposed to all be agricultural farming types. It has implication for technology. But technology now, as great as it may be, we can put a person on another planet. As great as it may be, technology now is hindered by sin nature. Imagine in that day as Jesus rules and reigns, when he lifts the haze and people can see clearly, technology will be released. Formulas that stumped Einstein will be solved by grade school children. Von Braun's wildest dreams become reality. Star Wars will look Amish. The arts will be released. Van Gogh will look like paint by number. Literature will be released. Shakespeare and all of his brilliance will read like Dr. Seuss in that day. Architecture, government, family, all made new under the work and the will of our Lord for 1,000 years. Imagine what life would be like that. We read that in that day, today, infant mortality is a real thing that we deal with, even apart from abortion. But in that day, we read in Isaiah 65, verse 20, no more shall there be an infant who lives but a few days. Sudden infant death syndrome is eradicated in that day. Those problems are solved. He goes on to say that if a guy dies at 100, we'll say, bless his heart, he went too soon. Can you imagine that? Somebody will say, I wonder what he was up to because he died too soon. He only lived 100 years. Today, according to the psalmist, we get 70 years, and if by strength, 80. If you're past 80, brother, you're on borrowed time. Count yourself fortunate. But in that day, if you die at 100, they'll say, oh man, he went so early. Why? Because suddenly all of that intelligence and all of that wisdom is able to be given to medical technology and to fixing the agricultural problems of our world. And suddenly we're seeing something akin to what we saw in the Old Testament, people living for hundreds of years. You see a man who's 150 years old, he looks like he's 30. Now, ladies, you should really look forward to that. You give so much time and spend so much money to look young. Do you understand? It's all about being a good Christian. In that day, under the rule and the reign of Jesus Christ, hey, folks, there'll be less stress in that day. How many of you could use a little less stress in your life? Traffic problems. All the things you gripe about suddenly will be eradicated. I can't wait for it. I mean, do you look forward to, can you imagine if you turn on Fox News or CNN or ABC or NBC and all they have is good news? Can you imagine that day? Imagine that day. Arthritis, no more. We don't need CPAP machines anymore. Some of y'all go to bed every night and you got to hook that old CPAP up. Snoring is eradicated. Can you imagine? Just imagine what the world will be like when all of the things that we struggle with here and now are lifted, at least for a time, for 1,000 years. Imagine what this world, all of our wildest dreams that are righteous, would come true during that time. What a day that will be. Do you agree with that? All right, here's the good news. You don't have to wait. You don't have to wait 7 years through hell on earth to make Jesus king. You can make him king right here and right now. You can subject yourself to him and say, I want him to rule. Like Joshua said, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to honor the Lord and take whatever is under your dominion and put it under his dominion. That's the meaning of life, is the glory of God and to live for his glory and to subject yourself to his rule and his reign. There is a sense in which, yes, he came to save us. He came to forgive us and he came to give us eternal life. But folks, you can't separate eternal life and new birth from citizenship. There is a very real sense that you cannot make him Savior without simultaneously subjecting yourself to his lordship. It's illogical. It's illogical for me to say, as a young man, as I was at 18 years of age, or today at 46, it's completely illogical for me to say, I believe God became flesh, he dwelt among us, he took all of my sins upon himself, he went to a rugged cross, he absorbed the wrath of God on my behalf, and he said, it is finished. He died, he was buried, and he was raised again, ascended to the right hand of the Father. And by faith in him, I can be forgiven and have eternal life, but I still think I know more about it than he does. And I'll do family the way I want to do it. I'll parent the way I want to parent. I'll spend my money the way I want to spend it, but I really appreciate the fire insurance, Lord. That's the most illogical, foolish, silly thing I've ever heard in my life. For somebody to say, well, he's my Savior, but I'm not going to make him Lord until I'm good and ready. I have a hard time believing that. If he is your Savior, and if you can believe, if you really believe that he died on the cross for your sins and overcame death, hell, and the grave, why can't you trust him with all of the lesser things? Why can't you just say, if he says go to church, bless God, I'm going to go to church. Where does he say that? Do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the habit of some is. But all the more as the day draweth near. It just makes sense. It's completely illogical. So Elijah said, if the Lord be God, follow him with everything you've got. But if there's another God, give your soul and life and every fiber of your being to that God. But don't straddle the fence. This is a day where we can't have any more Christians playing church, playing games. The darker it gets, the brighter the real thing will shine. And I want to see you living like lights in a dark world. And today you say, well, Pastor, are you telling me that if we submit ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ, that all those benefits of the kingdom are going to be ours? No, because not everybody else is going to get on board with that. You won't have them all, but you will have some. You'll have a taste of the world to come. You'll be, if some of you could just understand what it would be like to just sit on your back porch in a rocking chair with a glass of sweet tea and watch the sunset late in the evening with peace in your soul. That in itself would be enough for you to give your life to Jesus Christ. To watch the sunrise over the Atlantic and just to know that there's nothing between you and your Creator, that if you die, you have a home in heaven. Just peace, just a clear conscience, if you knew what it felt like, the joy it could give you, that in itself, apart from the threat of hell, apart from the hope of heaven, apart from all of the benefits of knowing Jesus Christ, if you just knew what peace internally felt like, if I could just take it out of my heart just for a couple of seconds and let you just feel of it, I promise you, you would break a leg trying to get down here to this altar. You won't get the fullness of it until He's here. But you get a taste of it. And oh, how sweet it is. If you don't know Him today, why not? Why wait another day? Give your life to Him while you still can. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. With heads bowed and eyes closed. How's life going? Do you have joy, peace? You know, some of the reason that we have so much war on the outside is there's a lot of war on the inside, according to the Apostle James. And solving the problems of the world began with solving the problems of the soul. And solving the problems of the soul began with bowing a knee to King Jesus. Now, with heads bowed and eyes closed, if you are one of our people that work outside and first impressions, you go ahead and be dismissed. You can slip out. When I'm trying to get people to come forward, I don't want people to have to walk around us to get down here. So if you need to slip out, you feel free to go ahead and slip out now. Now search your heart for a minute and ask yourself, are you at peace? Are you certain that you know God? Are your sins forgiven? Are you close and clean to Him? If not, I'm inviting you to make that right. I'm going to say a short prayer, and when I say amen, maybe some of you just need to come and have a prayer at this altar and just say, Father, forgive me. I know Jesus. I'm saved. But I've been sitting on the throne too much. And I need to get off and let you have it. Maybe you're here today and you've never genuinely given your life to Jesus Christ. Forget not His benefits. Would you come and do that today? Maybe you're here today and you say, well, Pastor, the Lord's been speaking to me about church membership, and I need to obey Him today. You know, making Him king, it's not one of those mystical type things. It's just doing what He says. And if He spoke to you about membership and you didn't join, if He told you to join this church and you didn't join, you're in disobedience. Why call us Him king and not do us the things that He says? Do what He says. Simple as that. I know that your heart, you want to. We're going to pray for you that God gives you courage and faith to obey Him. And as I pray, you just search your own heart and ask Him what He would have you to do. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank You, Lord, that You are so patient and so gracious to us. Father, You would not have any in this room to perish apart from Your saving grace. The door is wide open. There's nobody who has sinned in such a way that they cannot be saved today if they will. So, Lord, draw them to Yourself, and may they step out on faith and just take You at Your word and claim Your promise that whosoever believeth in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. Father, I pray for families, Lord, that You would please place them in a church family. And if it's here, Lord, make that clear to them, and may they come today. God, I pray for those who are just at a distance from you, Lord, that they just need a personal revival. Maybe last week somebody should have obeyed, but they didn't. God, give us the courage to make that right today. And Father, may people look at this church and this community and say, wow, something's different. And may we say it's our King. And it's in His name, Lord Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come as God draws.